One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show. You killed my queen.
Oh my God, I didn't mean it. Oh my God.
How are you feeling, you regicidal maniac?
It's just something I said. We were joking about the queen versus Willie, and I said, get lost, queen. I didn't know she was in this bad of shape. I didn't know the race was real. Oh, I feel bad.
It's not your fault.
Okay.
Although we did also kill Eddie Van Halen. We are developing a history of murdering people on this podcast.
We did. And we didn't tell Eddie to die like I told the Queen to get lost. We did an episode on Van Halen and then he died the next week.
We did an episode on Q Lazarus and then she died like the next year.
Okay. We're going to let that pass.
I don't know if we can take credit for that one, but we're definitely getting spooky around here. We're not a true crime podcast. We're a real crime podcast. We're out here committing murders.
Remind me, did Phil Spector already die?
I don't recall. We might have killed him too. We've killed so many people on this podcast. I can't possibly be expected to keep track.
We need to start doing some episodes of people we actually want to die and see where our power is.
That's a very good idea. And then when we get caught, we need to keep like murders in our back pocket, just like to lower our sentence. Just like, we'll tell you where the rest of the bodies are buried, but we just want to go to jail for 10 years.
I'm so sorry, but I am going to say, I'm not into the whole royal scene. But just, Twitter was a trip yesterday. And of course you have the people coming on being like, if you're just here to make jokes while a woman is dying, this is before it was announced. And I wanted to interrupt and be like, then you need to get off Twitter. Because that's what we do here, okay? We don't handle things correctly. We find the joke.
I called my mom immediately after the news. I was just like, just stay off social media. Like, you don't want to see any of this.
Well, what I was going to say is I thought I was just the one noticing it. And then it became a trend that everyone was talking about it. Because I follow a lot of Irish comedians. Like, we go to Ireland a lot. We had Brian Gallagher on the show. And I follow a lot of like stand-up comedians there. And I was like, oh, the Irish don't give a fuck.
No, they really don't.
They're like, bye. Like, they do not care. I was like, oh, this is the tea I'm kind of into right now.
Nobody's going to put it. We're both drinking tea. Hey, pinky out.
Hey, come on. I have little hands.
There we are.
I'm drinking tea for the queen, although I did put, what's the cinnamon whiskey?
You put a little fireball in your tea?
I put some fireball in my tea.
That's the way the queen liked it. I hope so. Her love of cinnamon whiskeys is well known. Going to the queen, she's banging shots of fireball. Give me another green tea. Smashing shots.
I do want to say, because I had to say it and I had to think about it, I had The Queen Is Dead by the Smiths in my head all day yesterday. And I finally was like, Diane, just play it. Just play it and maybe it'll quench it. And then no, it made it worse. But I played the song and then I just went ahead and let the whole album play. And I'm like, frankly, Mr. Shankly, that everything on that album is so good.
Queen Is Dead is a fantastic album. It really, really is.
Yeah.
And it's a great song. And we're going to get very sick of it over the next week.
Yes, we are.
And the King Charleses are not nearly as much fun as the King Williams. The King Williams are a lot of fun. Obviously, the Henrys are the most fun, but the Williams, I think, are the second most fun. The Charleses, I'm not so into. There were so many Georges and Edwards, it's hard to keep track.
Right.
Obviously, several Richards were evil.
Yes.
At least two Richards were significantly evil. Anyway, it's going to be fun. I'm definitely solidly in the skip King Charles and go straight to King William camp.
Yeah,
but there. We were shouted down at the Witan.
Yeah, all right. It'd be fun to see what happens. There's no Henrys even in the lineup, is there?
Well, I guess Harry is a Henry, I think.
Oh, okay.
I think that's right. He might
Okay.
be a Harold. The Harolds. There's only one Harold, and he was great.
Okay.
I'll tell you the story later. I'll tell you the story off air because it takes 6 hours.
Oh shit. All right. I'm in
I
your head.
got shit I gotta do. I gotta pick my kid up.
Okay. All right. All right.
That's enough being royal. Okay, today we're doing an episode of a band. This is kind of on the line of a thing that we promised when we started. I said I didn't want to do any bands that I absolutely hate. So two things. This is probably the band that we're going to do an episode on that I like the least, but I
Okay.
don't hate them. Like
I
I've
don't hate
learned,
them.
I've softened over time. I think the reason why my feelings about the Gin Blossoms were so hard was around the time that they came out. They hit it big in 93 when I was 13 and really starting to get kind of a little snotty about the music that I listened to and why I liked it. And these guys were just too damn happy. You know, like in 93, I was all about Nirvana. I was all about Pearl Jam. I mean, I was a 13-year-old boy, you know, at that time. So when the Gin Blossoms came out, they were just too fucking poppy. They felt plastic. You know, like posers, the worst thing you can be to a low teenage boy. They were posers.
Yes. And we're
And
going
they
to get
didn't.
into that because we're going to get into the whole tragic story of the song and the previous band member. This song does not read like a happy song, but they made the choice to play it happy and make a silly video that had nothing to do with these lyrics and the intention in these lyrics.
Yeah, they made it very power poppy, they made it very fun, they made it almost goofy. And obviously that's part of the appeal of it, but it is a pretty specifically sad and desperate song. And maybe that's part of the appeal, obviously, is like the dichotomy. Like if you really listen to the lyrics, it's not nearly as cheerful as they make it out to be. And then you get into the backstory, it completely changes. That's why I wanted to do this song, because you do a close reading of it. And it reads exactly like it is literally, and then you find out the story of what happened afterwards, and it changes the way that you think about the song 180 degrees. Like it's
I
just,
wish I knew the story back then. It's like
I don't know how I
30 years
didn't.
later, I'm finding out the story.
Yeah, for all the MTV that I watched, how their second album called Congratulations, I'm Sorry is specifically about what happened. Like it
Wow.
must have been there. I don't know how. Like I didn't find this out until I think I heard this story for the first time researching some other episode we were doing like a year ago. So I don't know. It only occurred to me like a year ago. It's amazing to me that I avoided it. With all the MTV I watched when I was a kid, I should have known about this.
I know. I know.
Shall we do it? This is Hey Jealousy by the Gin Blossoms. I'm sorry, it's a real earworm. If it gets stuck in your head for a week, my fault. I
Yeah.
apologize.
No, let's do it.
Super happy song, Hey Jealousy by the Gin Blossoms.
Well, tell me, do you think it'd be all right if I could just crash here tonight? You can see I'm no sheep for driving, and anyway, I've got no place to go.
Well, tell me, do you think it'd be all right if I could just crash here tonight? You can see I'm in no shape for driving, and anyway, I've got no place to go. So here we go. It's a drunk appeal for
Yep.
sure. Like it's,
Showing up at her dorm.
I would imagine you've had run-ins with dudes like this in your early 20s.
I was in relationships, so no, but I did have it in high school where a boyfriend, we had kind of broken up, and he showed up to my house where I lived as a teenager with my parents home, knocked on my door, and I opened it up, and he just looked at me, and he was plastered. I mean, so drunk. And he just looked at me and then he starts laughing while he's walking backwards. And he goes, "You're so mad at me." And when he walks backwards, he tripped and fell and landed back on his back and head, like drunk as shit. And I just
Oh,
remember like shaking my head and like seeing my dad over my shoulder, like, "What the fuck just happened?" And I just shut the door. I was like,
no.
"Don't worry about that."
He'll be fine. He'll get it sorted out in the morning.
Not driving. I just have to shut the door.
It's a certain type of young man. I definitely did it a few times. That like I don't know if it's a strategy. I don't think it's a conscience thought, but it's definitely a thing that a certain kind of guy does. Like, I
Well,
love you so much, I have to get really good and ripped and go tell you all about
and then
it.
be like, I could have gone to any of my buddy's house or a hotel, but I think this was a good idea. You're gonna
Exactly.
love me tonight with all your pity.
She needs to know right now. It's
Yeah.
like the Andy Higgins joke. I'm trying to bring out her maternal instinct.
Yeah, that's great.
It's, you know, it might not be that bad. You were the best I'd ever had. If I hadn't blown the whole thing years ago, I might not be alone.
Come take care of the drunk. Back to this, and you know it might not be that bad. You were the best I ever had. So there's the another drunken appeal. Come on, it was good, baby. Everything
Yeah.
else might have been bad, but the sex was always great.
Yep.
Sure thing, dummy.
Appeal to her pity even more. Like, I just loved you. You're the best.
Oh, I thought you said appeal to her pussy. I'm sorry, pity, pity. Just so
Whoa.
we
I don't
okay.
think this move appeals to any woman's pussy.
That's clearly what he's trying to do. That is a straight up, like, that's not hidden. There's no floral, there's no floridity in the lyrics. And you know,
No.
it might not be that bad. You were the best I ever had. He's obviously drunk and begging for sex.
It might
If
not
I
be.
hadn't blown the whole thing years ago, I might not be alone. Okay, so we're also full of self-pity. You throw some self-pity on top of the drunkenness and he's irresistible.
He's like, and I probably can't get it up, but
Yeah.
we should totally do this.
It's gonna be fun for you to try though. You're gonna like try it. Think of it as a challenge.
I'm saying it was my fault. So, and it might not be that bad because we were good when we were, I wasn't a fuck up,
Yeah.
right? Right? I
It's
can't.
not you, it's me and my best friend's 16 cans of Busch Tall Boys.
I mean, I'm ready to go with this guy, right?
And here comes his big push in the chorus.
Tomorrow we can drive around this town and let the cops chase us around. The past is gone, but something might be found. The ticket's placed. Hey, jealousy.
Tomorrow we can drive around this town and let the cops chase us around. He's a bad boy. The past is gone, but something might be found to take its place. Hey, jealousy. Hey, jealousy.
Okay, this is where I have the big question. I do not understand how the line "Hey, jealousy" fits into the song. Who's jealous? Who's je I what? I don't get it.
I think he's just jealous that she's got a life without him. I think that's all of it. I think it's literally exactly what it is. He is showing up at her door, blitzed and wasted. He's got no other place to go. He's full of regret and self-hatred. And now he's just like he's trying to remind her of whatever good times they used to have. The only thing that's on his dude brain is the sex and the romantic danger. It's the only appeal he can make.
Okay. I just feel like "Hey, pity" would have been a better line, but you need the three syllables, I guess.
I think he's also, yeah, you need the three syllables, and he's also acknowledging that it's like I don't think he can sing like "Hey, pity." It's got to be jealousy because that's the like it's a negative emotion that he's admitting to. But if he was just admit like a song that's just self-pitying yourself, that's gonna get tired. See some Morrissey tunes. We get it. You don't have to be so shitty with yourself.
Yeah, true.
This is an interesting lyric. The second lyric, he goes.
Can trust me not to think and not to sleep around. And if you don't expect too much from me, you might not be let down.
And the official lyrics are, and you can trust me not to think and not to sleep around. And if you don't expect too much from me, you might not be let down. That's the straight up come on there. Now, not getting ahead of ourselves, but the guy who wrote this song gets very acrimoniously thrown out of this band because of his drinking. The original lyric was, and you can trust me not to drink and not to sleep around. If you don't expect too much from me, you might not be let down. And apparently that was a direct come on that the lead singer Doug Hopkins would make to women in bars. They changed the lyric because they didn't want to be reminded of what a drunken mess Doug Hopkins had turned into. And in releasing the song, obviously that made the original lyricist Hopkins very, very upset because they took the specific intimacy away from him. More on that later. Because all I really wants to be with you and feeling like I matter too, you know.
That hurts.
Yeah. Like, I think, I know I've definitely been there.
Yeah. Yeah. Everyone has that line, feeling like I matter too. And I was like, that's what I wanted more of in this song, of getting into how he actually feels about being a drunken loser.
Yeah, I think a little bit more thoughtfulness. And it is kind of strange because we're almost at the end of the song. If I hadn't blown the whole thing years ago, I might be here with you. So he does get it. Like he does, he is kind of making a turnaround. There is a bit of alcoholic realization there. Yeah. I mean, the first step is admitting you have a problem. Well, there, he's made it. Now, you know, 11 more to go, huh?
Well, what I think is funny about the guy who originally wrote this song, wrote, "You Can Trust Me Not to Drink." He's saying this to a woman that he's shown up at her house drunk. Saying, can I stay here? You can trust me not to drink. And she's like, well, can I? I mean,
this is the last time, I promise.
You're drunk right now.
I've made promises like that. Yeah. The chorus repeats, and the last line of the song is, "Hey, jealousy, she took my heart. Well, there's only one thing I couldn't start." I think he's admitting to it in that last line. Like I spent some time tapping the pencil on that last line. She took my heart. Well, there was only one thing I couldn't start. And I think the one thing he couldn't start is quitting drinking, like quitting the booze. I think that's what he's saying. Like the only thing I couldn't start is living well.
Yes. Right. So,
This guy strikes me as the kind of guy who doesn't mind, like he'll strike a match anywhere. You know, he's kind of got some drunken fearlessness, some drunken Superman to him. But I think he realizes that obviously that's not going to get him. It's not going to get him the girl that he wants. You know, like showing up all pathetic like this, he obviously understands that it ain't going to work. Yeah. But the only arrow in his quiver.
All right. Are you going to tell us the story, the tragic story?
Here comes the sadness.
Let's do it.
First of all, you were hinting at it in our previous episode. I had to look it up. Why the gin blossoms are called the gin blossoms.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. What is it?
It's I don't even know how to describe it. It's something that you see, I think W.C. Fields had it. Yeah. Someone who is a hardcore alcoholic, they get these like rosy red, sometimes it's just spots on their nose and sometimes it develops into these like little petal like.
Yeah, the great big ruddy ruby red nose of a long-term alcoholic.
Yeah.
And they did get it from W.C. Fields. They're called gin blossoms.
Yeah. It's
so it sounds kind of nice and hopeful, but also,
I mean, because I was like, when I was younger, I knew gin came from like a juniper plant, or am I getting that right?
Right.
And then like it flowers, and I just thought it was a wallflowers, gin blossoms. Like, I don't know, like it was just a nice name. And then someone along the line pointed out what a gin blossom was, and I was like, oh,
hey.
Okay.
That's a little bit more frightening and instructive. I'm gonna have to lay off the gin.
Yeah.
Or you'll end up like the queen.
Isn't it funny how all the things that can go wrong internally, like your liver, we can't see our liver, all these things, but when it vanity, like, oh, my face is ugly, I'm quitting.
Every time I think about why I need to stop smoking and curb the drinking, that is number two on the reasons list, is like, you're gonna get grizzled. You're an old bartender. It's gonna happen.
Yeah, it's gonna age you. I mean, you see it like you see it with some of, and you see it easier and quicker with women. Like when you see a woman who's lived a hard life, and that's always how I explain it. Like she's lived hard. Like she smoked and drank and lived in bars and didn't sleep. And man, it shows up on women's faces, I think, a lot harder. I mean, men can hide stuff with beards and stuff too. But
we're also considered. We're wise and weathered, you know. If your face gets a little cracked like Clint Eastwood, you can still be appealing. Like that just means you're experienced. You're a cowboy, baby.
Yeah, not women. We need to look 16 forever, or they're like, "Oof, what happened to her?" I'm like, she turned 45. Give her a fucking break. God damn it.
So the gin blossoms are from Tempe, Arizona, which is not exactly a rock and roll hotbed. It's just kind of a normal suburban town, which is sort of, maybe that's part of the reason why I found the Gin Blossoms to be so disposable, because they came from exactly where I come from. You know, they weren't giving me any kind of new perspective. That could be one of the reasons. But they were sort of raised on poppy kind of punky bands, like the ones we love, you know, the Pixies, the Replacements, bands like that. REM was a big influence for them. You can hear that in Doug Hopkins' guitar. Doug Hopkins is sort of the central character of the band when they get together. He's like their genius. But unfortunately, like some geniuses, he's dark and tortured. And certainly sounds like he's playing up the dark and tortured musical genius thing. I read a couple of long articles in Rolling Stone about the history of the Gin Blossoms. And somehow or another, I found a weird link to a small article it's like the Detroit Metro Times that was written by Doug Hopkins' drinking buddy. And it just reminded me of how kind of insane it is. Like, and I see it all the time, bartending. Men particularly sort of sort themselves based on their drinking habits and their drug habits, right? Like you just find a level. Like if the guy doesn't drink at the level that you do, you don't hang out with him. If he's far too far gone, it's painful to hang out with him. He's not as much fun, then it's boring to hang out with him.
Yeah.
People sort based on how much beer they want to drink.
Yeah.
And that's this guy's article. He was Doug Hopkins' best friend, and he really went or at least drinking buddy. But he sort of went in depth as to sort of how far along the alcohol ride Hopkins went. He's the chief songwriter of the Gin Blossoms, and he wrote Hey Jealousy. They kind of rise to the top of the heap in Tempe, Arizona, which is not far from Los Angeles. And they get this nice write-up in like the LA Free Press or you know, that talks about how they're kind of looking down their nose at Tempe, Arizona, saying, okay, it's not a rock and roll hotbed, but the best band you've never heard of are these guys called the Gin Blossoms out of Tempe, Arizona. They had this reputation as the best unsigned band. So there's a bit of a derby to sign them, and they end up signing a record deal with A&M Records. They take the whole band out to LA to record an album, and it's a disaster. Oh. It's a disaster because Hopkins can't get his shit together, and he's the creative force in the band. Like the other guys are just like I mean, they're great songwriters, and they have songs on the album as well. They're not along for a free ride, but he's definitely the one who's running the show, and the show is terrible. They end up, you know, they spend $100,000 on this and just absolutely crash and burn, and end up having to go back to Tempe. They take another run at it because they just seem so promising. I mean, it looks like the album is covered in hits, and it turns out that it is.
Yeah.
So they take them to, I think it's Nashville, to a studio there. And that's when things get really, really good and bad. Now, at this point, Doug Hopkins has taken a couple of runs at getting sober, but it hasn't worked out. So he's in the studio, and he's literally at the point where he can't play if he's sober, because he's got the shakes so bad. He's got the delirium tremens. He can't pick out the notes. He can't play guitar. But if he drinks to soothe it, then he has to drink so much that now he's too drunk to play. So he's literally in the alcoholic rock in a hard place. Like, I can't get cool enough to do it sober. And as soon as I drink, I'm far too drunk to accomplish what I need to set out for. So it's nothing but sad. It's just nothing but sad. And reading the article that his friend wrote, it's proper sad, you know, it's soiling yourself sad. It's really good and desperately, properly drunken sad.
Yeah.
Does manage on a good day to scratch out the guitar solo for Hey Jealousy. And that becomes a real sticking point because the record label obviously insists, like, okay, you guys can't go forward with this guy. You need to fire him. So they do. They complete the album with somebody else on guitar, and they fire him, but they keep his songs on the album, and they keep his playing on Hey Jealousy. The album gets released, and the band goes on tour. Doug Hopkins returns to Tempe, Arizona, and his depression. He starts a few more bands, and obviously now he's, you know, he needs vindication, so he's all riled up, and he's given quotes to the local Arizona press about how he's going to wipe the floor with the Gin Blossoms, and, you know, he'll be back, that kind of stuff. Meanwhile, the Blossoms are slowly, it's not, the album's not a big hit out of the blocks. It takes three times they release a video for Hey Jealousy, and it doesn't really catch on with MTV until the third time. And it was kind of strange because a band member, the lead singer Robin, was saying that the first video that they released cost $5,000, and then the record company came back and said, well, we're going to make a second video for $10,000. And then they came back and said, we're going to make a third video for $40,000. Like, that's how much they believed in this song, Hey Jealousy, which starts to become a hit in like 1993 and stays on the radio forever.
Yes, it did.
Did it ever? Like, it's still like you could probably still put on like 94.5, you know, all the alternative rock stations and still hear it. I was reading an article that was talking to these station managers that were saying like they've never seen a song test the way that it did. Mm-hmm. They said that they would every week, you know, they test their playlists, and Hey Jealousy never got a downvote or never got, it was like, no, just keep playing it for like a year and a half. Like, they've never seen a single that had legs that long. Like, even the really, really big classic rock hits or super big pop hits, eventually everybody gets sick of it. You will get sick of running up that hill, kids. You will. It's going to happen soon.
Yes. I mean, I loved that song, and it was like, that's enough. We're good. We got it.
We did it, everyone. But that never, and that's why I hated the Gin Blossom so much, is because this song is fucking following me around and it's driving me absolutely batshit.
Yeah.
It's weirdly satisfying to think that the guy who actually wrote that song felt so much worse about it than I did.
Yeah.
Like, I'm following you around. Look what it's doing to me. Like, so his bandmates, his friends, the guys that he's worked with are now living his dream, like, slowly but surely. He gets an $1,800 check. They played Letterman. And because they played Hey Jealousy, it's his song, so he gets publishing off of it. And he starts getting these relatively small publishing checks. And his musician friends around Tempe start trying to cheer him up. They're just like, look, you're living your dream. Like, everyone is singing your song. The kids all over this country are digging your music. That means you can do it. These checks are going to get bigger. The album ended up selling something like 3 million copies. But they came to, the band had to come back to him and say, you have to sign away half of your publishing rights because we have to give it to our new guitarist, just so that there's no infighting in the band as it currently is. Hopkins needed the money so badly that he took it. And obviously that really, really upset him. So the Gin Blossoms are playing a local boys come home, you know, their big like make good show at their local club, which they're far, far too big to play now. Yeah. And Hopkins is there, and he gets in a fight with a lead singer and pummels him on stage. Gosh, and ejected from the venue. It's proper rock and roll shit. Like, it's, I mean, talk about Hey Jealousy. I mean, that's,
ooh. Oh my God. Talk about full circle.
Mm-hmm. I imagine, like, I can only imagine that they must have played Hey Jealousy like right after that. Like, he gets punched in the face and knocked out. The guy gets escorted out of the venue. They just immediately pop up and just go, "Hey, Jealousy."
Oh, that's kismet. That's wild. I didn't know this whole part of the story that he. And it's just one of the. Why would you go? I guess he could not go, and he knew full well, I'm gonna go and have some bad intentions.
Yeah, I have no doubt that he had bad intentions. I also felt like he probably had like a reputation that needed defending. You know, like, he, obviously he was in his dude alcohol laced brain. This seemed like a good idea. Clearly, it's not.
It's unfair to the new lead singer. He's like, I didn't know you. I didn't know that,
man. Well, they were friends. They all knew each other. They. Yeah,
oh, even the new lead singer, like, okay.
They've known each other and were songwriting partners. They've known each other a long time, and they still had a lot of mutual respect. Like, the lead singer still has, you know, kind things to say, and still wonders, you know, what might have happened. You know, he talks about him in terms of like, no, this guy was the greatest songwriter any of us had ever seen. He was one. He was just like a legendary guy around town, around like in his music scene. Everybody around there acknowledged like nobody could write a song the way that this guy could. Like,
yeah,
our very best song is not as good as Doug Hopkins' worst song. Like, he could just dash him off. And apparently he did all parts. Like, when he wrote a song, it wasn't just like, hey, I got a guitar line, I've got an idea for a melody or something like that, and we'll work on it together. Like, he's almost like a Dave Grohl with the first Foo Fighters album, where he would show up with a song and it's bass, drums, guitar, harmonies. Everything's all set and ready to go, boys. That's my song.
Why is it always like that? That someone who can fire on all those levels also has to fire on all the levels of like, I can't control my emotions, I can't control my addictions. Like, they're just on fire everywhere, and it's so sad.
I think it's just living out loud. I think there are certain kinds of artists who get to that point where the only way that they feel like they can create is if they just break themselves wide open. You know,
Yeah.
if they're just nothing but shattered on the floor, then that's when everything comes out. You know, they don't
Yeah.
necessarily learn how to use their tool. You know, if this guy had lived a healthier life, who knows what he'd be doing right now? Like, he
You'd be
might
writing really boring songs. That's what it is. Yeah, you don't just put all your pity and shit out there when you're trying to heal and conserve. You know, I mean,
Yes.
yeah, it makes sense.
Yep. He needed to go, instead of going to the bar, he needed to go to a tarot card reader. Just a couple of tarot card readings, and I think you get back in touch with the universe. Center yourself, young man.
You need to go to a fucking therapist in AA,
Yeah.
Ben.
I'm
Sorry,
talking
I
about what might
disagree.
happen in this room. There's no chance this guy's going to a therapy or AA.
Oh boy.
He gets awarded a gold record.
Oh.
Yeah. The album New Miserable Experience goes gold. Obviously, it's later going to go triple platinum. It goes gold, and he gets a gold record. Like, he's got like the proper, you know, like when you see like these famous artists in the studio, and Elton John's got 17,000 platinum records everywhere. He's got that.
I've
He's
been
got
to
the big,
Graceland.
yeah, the big recording industry of America, big gold disc, and it's hanging in his shitty apartment in Tempe, Arizona, which is full of tipped over ashtrays and empty beer
I was gonna
cans and
say, is he flinging
whatever
bottles
shit.
at it?
Yeah, it's probably the only thing hanging on the wall. Like, it's just
It's
bizarre to
crooked.
me. Yeah, of course it's. His friends say that they knew that things were probably going to take a very serious turn when they found that he destroyed his gold record. Like, just did a bit of pique in a fit of rage. He smashed the gold record all over the place, took it down, and took no pride whatsoever in the success that his songs were enjoying, which you would think, obviously, you know, he's got some bitterness. Obviously, he's got alcohol issues. But I am really surprised that he wasn't able to enjoy watching the song bubble out of the ether, because that's the magic that we talk about all the time. Like, this is your song. You wrote it in your bedroom. It was just you and your friends sitting around, and now it's out there getting into everybody's ears. It's what you
Nah,
always wanted. Like, I don't
tied
understand
to
find
too much.
some joy in that.
No, it's tied to too much guilt of his own failure. His he should have been
Yeah.
out there singing it. It was his, and he lost it because he couldn't control himself. Yeah.
He's trying to get it together. He goes to a detox facility in Tempe, and he's going in for like the I don't know what they call it, but like your intake interview.
Yeah.
You know, they're gonna like they're find out where you are, and you know what you've been doing, what kind of drugs you're on, how long have you been doing it. Like, he goes and he goes through that part of the interview process and realizes that he can't take it. So he literally climbs a chain link fence in a hospital gown
Oh
with
my
the back ass flapping in the breeze, you know, jumps the fence and flees, you know, and he goes to a pawn store, and he buys a gun, and he goes to his apartment, and he calls his friend, this guy who ended up writing the article, and says, I'm gonna do it, you know, tonight's the night. And these guys had been down the drinking rabbit hole with each other time and time again. So this guy talking about suicide and offing himself is nothing new. So his friend does his best to try to talk him out of it and cheer him up. You know, just like, hey, you don't have to do that. I'll come pick you up. We're gonna go to that whorehouse in Nogales. You're gonna love it. Like,
Oh
you
my
know, that
God.
kind of thing. Just hang on. But he hangs up the phone and doesn't think anymore. Doesn't think it's any more serious. But then the next day, you know, his friends find him. You know, he'd shot himself in that apartment with the smashed gold record and all the detritus of being an alcoholic wasteoid kind of surrounding him.
Any idea how old he was?
32.
Okay. This wasn't a 27 club.
No, it wasn't a 27 Club thing. But just so incredibly sad. And it just like, I just couldn't, is it changes the way you look at the whole song. Like, on a literal reading, like, this is obviously a drunk, wild dude
Yeah.
trying to get back, you know, with the girl that he misses. But when you know what happened, when you know the feelings that he went through, you know, when you learn why he basically drank himself to death and committed suicide, you start to read the song as him pleading with the band. Like now that I know the story, every time I read it, like it's like he's not knocking on the door of the girl's apartment. He's knocking on the door of the studio or the dressing room.
It plays exactly like that now. That is so rich.
Mm-hmm. It's a total flip. That's why I wanted to do this episode, because it's just like that is a 180 degree turn.
He's like a Nostradamus. Hey, jealousy makes sense now. The line, hey, jealousy. I didn't understand hey, jealousy when it was in terms of like a failed relationship and a girl he's trying to get back with. It's like he saw the future, because, I mean, he couldn't have known he was going to get kicked out of the band and the song was going to rocket to the top. But now the line, hey, jealousy makes glorious sense.
Yeah. I think he must have suspected that this problem is going to get me thrown out of everything I love in my life eventually. Like if I don't get this under control, it's obviously going to cost me everything. He must have known that it was costing him his guitar playing. He must have known it was costing him his ability to perform. He clearly knew it was costing him his relationships with his bandmates. Like I definitely think that all of that taken on a whole, I think it must have worked its way into the song.
Whoa, now this song should be like studied in college just because of like how much more sense it makes at the end of the story than in the beginning when he wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's so forward thinking that it's mind-blowing.
It's mind-blowing and tear-jerking. I don't think I'll ever hear this song again without going like, oh god.
Feeling like I matter too. I matter because I wrote the fucking song and you guys are famous now. If I had blown the whole thing years ago, I might be here with you. Wow. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
That's incredible. God, in my shitty mind, I was like, this guy killed himself over a mediocre song. But now my mind is blown. It's not. The whole story is, it's nothing mediocre about it.
He killed himself because he had all the talent in the world, all the opportunity in the world, and he blew it at the key moment. Like he literally blew it at the apex, you know, like here we're recording this album right now. And he's too fucked up to get the job done. Don't do it. Oh. You have to be sober enough to seize your opportunities, kiddos.
When did you find out this story? Cause I would have never, I don't think this would have ever like been put in front of my face. Did someone tell you this or did you stumble upon it?
I think I don't remember who we were researching, but I was researching a song, like I think like on my phone, all of these, oh, so you're interested in music articles popping up. And I think there was an article just called like the tragic story of the gin blossoms. I was just like, And there was part of me, like the emotional vampire, the horrible dude in me was just like, I want to know that something bad happened to those guys. And then that happened, I was just like, you're a horrible person, Ben. What?
Oh, I'm the same way. But don't feel hard on yourself. We all are. We're just like, ew, this is why we like dig in the guts of a story. We're like, what is wrong with us? I want to see the nasty stuff.
But I think that's Hey Jealousy by the Gin Blossoms. Do you feel cheerful?
No. Thank you. I got out of bed to do this. I'm gonna go back to bed. God, I've had like no, it's been a week. I've had no motivation to do anything, but I'm glad we have this podcast so I can, you know, get out of the sheets and
get into this headspace.
Yeah, great. Thank you, Ben. This is great.
You're welcome. When's your next therapy session? Soon, I hope.
It was yesterday. it was Wednesday. Yeah, that'd be so funny if I come in and I'm like, I just have to tell you the story of the gin blossom. She's like, let's focus on you. All right. I went round and round and round with my deep cut this week. So I started compiling a list. I go through my phone, I go to Apple Music, I go to songs, and I just scroll. And I was like, oh yeah, that's one, that's a good one. And so I started compiling a list. And I was like, oh, I did like these songs. I don't know which one I want to do. And I went back and forth. And so what I chose a song that I like a lot, but it wouldn't be worth covering on the podcast because the whole song is really just like three lyrics, like three lines. But it has such a strong message that it just makes so much sense in the times that we are in now. I chose I Want to Be Adored by the Stone Roses. Okay. Do you remember that song?
No, I don't think so.
It's just him saying, I want to be adored a lot. I don't mean to sell. I don't need to sell my soul. He's already in me. I don't need to sell my soul. So The Stone Roses were one of these bands that came out of Manchester, like in the late 80s, alongside bands such as Happy Mondays and The Charlatans. And what's so funny is when I was putting my list together, right under I Want to Be Adored was a song that I want to do by The Charlatans and a song by The Happy Mondays. I was like, okay, Diane, apparently you have a type. Like, and when you go and watch the videos for I Want to Be Adored and the song I Wanted to Do by The Charlatans, the band members look alike, they dress alike, they move on stage similar. Like, they were all just like a posse, which I think eventually developed into more famous, like Oasis and, you know, bands like that, and The Verve and all that kind of stuff. But
James is a Manchester band from the same era.
Yes, yes. And yeah, they all kind of have the same thing. And like In Spiral Carpets, that's another one I put. I almost chose a song by In Spiral Carpets for my deep cut today. And they're all very, very similar. But this song, it sounds like he's saying he's talking about himself, but he's like, no, I'm not talking about me. It's how individuals want to be idolized and how we would do anything to attain that goal. He didn't actually want people to adore him. He was saying, if you want to be adored, it's like a sin, like lust or gluttony or something like that. And it, you know, it's just a really pretty melodic song, but it's just this guy repeating over and over how much he wants to be adored. And I just feel like in this days of, I just think of young girls now, teenage girls, girls in their 20s, and it's even men now, just what we do with our social medias, like people begging for followers and like my picture and look at the best side of me. And I'm just like, this is dangerous and dirty, and people have to stop, because you're gonna get older, and then what? What are you reaching for?
It's like we all have front man's vanity now.
Yes. You know?
There's a bar that I like to go to where they always joke, just like, this is a bar for lead guitarists and bassists. It is not front men, and it's certainly not for drummers.
That's really great.
I gotta go because I got front man's disease. At least I acknowledge that I have front man's disease. I know it. It's there. I'm working on it.
Sure. I mean, everybody does. I mean, and look what we're competing now, where I feel like we didn't used to compete before social media, but we also, we all know it's fake. And what I hate is like that we've ever seen follower counts, because it's never been about followers for me. I mean, I would like a lot of people to hear this podcast, so maybe we could get ads and sponsorship and I can make some money and feel like I'm contributing to my family with something I like to do for that reason. But like, I don't give a shit how many people like my photos. I don't. And I can't make people understand that. I was like, my obsession with social media and taking photos is because I've been obsessed with documenting my life my whole life. And I love going back and looking. But people who genuinely are out there saying, I need more followers, I'm like, what is it you actually need? There's something else you need, and it's not that. And it's
definitely attention. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You've got to create for the love of creation. Like, you have to love doing the thing that you do, not the result that you get from it, or not the acclaim that you get from it.
Yeah. If you put more into that actual love of yourself and love of your arts, you will get the attention probably. But when you're just begging for it, people are like, ugh.
That's just straight up being present in the moment. Enjoy the process, you know, the basics of living a good day.
Yes. Anyway, I just thought that this song should have come out now instead of like back in late 80s. It was very late 80s, I think, when it came out, but I'll play a clip of it. It's a really good song. I don't need to sell my soul. Do you have a deep cut?
I do. Yeah. It's by The Clash, and it's a song called Bank Robber, which actually, like, I had to look it up because, like, to me, it's a deep cut. It's not on any of like their official album. It's on like, I think Black Market Clash and the story of The Clash. But I looked it up just to make sure that it was indeed a deep cut. And I guess it got to like number 12 on the UK charts. So it's not a deep cut in the UK, but I don't know that there are too many American, I think it'd be a lot. Like, if I played, you know, Bank Robber, a lot of people would just be like, is this The Clash? I've never heard this song before. But it's not, It's hard to describe. Like, it's just got the, you know, the drum beat as it comes in is amazing. I don't know what instrument is making, you know, this wobbly bass line that's beneath it. And then it's just the best, to me, the best example of Joe Strummer's just incredible rock and roll voice, because he's just all hoarse-throated. He just starts belting out the lyrics. My daddy was a bank robber, but he never hurt nobody. And I love it because, like, his thick English accent comes through. And I don't know why, it just seems like so much more rock and roll to me when I hear that English accent snarl. I don't know why, but it's like, it's a song that's, it just makes me want to sing along with Joe. Like, every time I hear it, it's like, I want my voice to do that. I want to be that gravelly rock and roll snarling Englishman. You know, it's almost like a country, like an outlaw country and Western tune. And it may be, I don't know who wrote it. I don't think like, it could very well be like an old, you know, country standard, but it's basically, you know, it's almost like a John Dillinger style. Like, they hint at it. There's lyrics like, if they can't find the hole in the, or if I can't find the hole in the wall, I know that they never will. So he's literally like, I can't even find my own hideout at the end of the day.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very like, I wonder if the sequel is I Fought the Law and the Law Won.
Yes. Yeah, I hadn't thought about that, but they are. Yeah. They're definitely companion pieces, because the Clash obviously did cover that one too. Yeah.
Yeah,
I've been listening to those songs back to back and never even saw the connection.
I know. They were living in a headspace just then. Yeah, that's really cool. All right. Well, next week we have our final Patreon member before we put all the names back in the boxes. And this was Yo Friend. And what's funny is we've spoken of this song before, but never thought to cover it. We are going back to Faith No More. Thank you, James Brown. And we are doing their cover of Easy, which I have said is, I love it. I love Mike Patton and I love his cover of Easy. And I'm really excited to play clips of it and have everybody hear him singing it.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, it's gonna be fun. All right.
Take care of your gin blossoms.
Okay, I'm gonna work. I should probably put this fireball away.
Yeah, all right. Okay, try not to murder anybody this week.
All right, thank you.
And
Vogue. 1, 2, 3. Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees and to Sarah Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.